Hi, everybody. This is Congressman Paul Gosar. Just getting ready to catch a plane back to Arizona. It's been a busy week here. We were very successful, but very, very busy. We actually passed 7 of 7 amendments that we offered on appropriations bills, looking out for you and getting back a smaller government, more nimble government that was responsive to you, we the people. So let's take some questions.
Denise Melton asks, why do bureaucratic agencies make law? I thought and was taught that only the legislative branch can make law. How can the EPA simply regulate our water rights away from us?
Well, that's a great question, Denise, because just recently we had to pass a bill in which I was a co-sponsor on called Waters of the U.S., prohibiting the overreach of the EPA into realms of water that they never were entrusted to do. In fact, their new regulations actually defy 4 Supreme Court rulings, or parts of 4 Supreme Court rulings, saying that they have to go back to Congress in which to guide that. But you're exactly right. Laws are created by the legislative branch, which is in the House and Senate, and the signature of the president. And if they don't have jurisdiction along those lines, they're supposed to come back to us for that. But these agencies are also are responsible for putting out the rules and regulations. And they also have to be very germane to actually the application. And that's where we're going to have a fight, getting that back under the realm of Congress, the cost of them, and making sure that Congress intended to do exactly that. But that's why we're in the fight that we are. The administration feels like they can usurp Congress, and we in Congress believe we have to be the integral part about creating new laws. Hang in there.
Joel Spielman on Twitter asks, Rep. Gosar, is there any way to reverse the current Forest Service plans and increase logging in our forests? Trees are too close together.
Joel, that's a great question. Once upon a time in Arizona, we had a vibrant logging industry, and today we're relegated to almost none. We're victims of big fires like the Wallow Fire, and it was the largest in Arizona history in my first term, and then my second term was marred by the loss of 19 firefighters put in circumstances that, frankly, was an accident waiting to happen. Some good news is that we were able to open some tracts of some 300,000 acres in which the logging industry can start getting back in and thinning the forest. But this is going to be an onslaught that's going to take not only actions from me, but from you, the people back home, to make sure that we do this right, that we inventory and make sure that there's plenty of opportunities to thin the forest and to make sure that it follows the science. But you're exactly right. Too close to trees, the trees catch on fire instead of keeping it in the grass.
Char Mullen asks, what is the GOP plan for insuring those who may lose their insurance if the Supreme Court decides against subsidies for Obamacare?
Char, great question. You know, the GOP is actually looking at a number of options. Ron Johnson, Heritage, Paul Ryan, Tom Price, even the Republican Study Committee, in which I'm one of the original authors, put something together. One of the things we have to look at is this will be a transitional case. There won't be just a take out of Obamacare and put something back in. The president will never go for that. So what we do is we have to have more insurance opportunities, more choice to pick from, whether it be a higher deductible, lower copay. Everybody needs a choice. And that's why I've been one of those people that want to break up the insurance industry. So we have more opportunity, more choices, just like the rest of us are treated. But this is going to be an interesting tick for tack because it's going to take some time. Obamacare didn't come in overnight, and it won't go out overnight. And so there's got to be a way in which we transition. And that's still up to discussion. But if you got an idea, we'd love to hear back from you.
Sarah Smith asks, I have heard you talk before about coming from a big family. Are you all Republicans? Does your family fight about politics like mine does?
What's the old adage, Sarah, about no politics or religion at the dinner table? Well, that was an exception to the rule at our house. I'm the first of 10 kids, and there are 6 Democrats, 3 Republicans, 1 independent. In fact, the first time my wife ever met my family, she called her mom and said, oh my God, these people hate each other. We're passionate about life, we're passionate about politics, and we're passionate about the ideas that we hold. And that's what America is all built upon, the freedom of speech and having the free exercise to persuade everybody else on why your aspect is right. For all those that asked the question, I thank you. It shows you're involved in the political process. Keep them coming. We'll keep doing this on and off through the rest of the year so that we have a direct relationship to listening to the people. You are the government, and you should be asking great questions like you did just now. and there should be answers coming back from Washington, D.C. You know, God gave us two ears and one mouth. That's listen twice as much as we speak. And I think that's a good learning lesson for all politicians and bureaucrats alike. So thanks for the great questions.